Public Library District Board of Trustees to order. It is 7:02 p.m. on Wednesday, January 21st, 2016. May I please take the roll?
Karen?
Yes.
Carolyn?
Here.
Is it this one? I thought it was notice.
It is the 20th, isn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, you have the 20th. That's why I thought 21st on that. Sorry.
Barbara?
Here.
Patty gave us previous notice. Linda?
Here.
Tim?
Here.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay, first item on the agenda is the consent agenda to approve the minutes of the regular board meeting of December 16th, 2015. Approve the payment of the bills for operating expenses of $170,089.18. Payroll expenses of $292,349.57. Special reserve expenses of $32,431.99. With a total monthly expense of $494,870.74.
So moved.
But thanks. C, approve payment to Visio Graphic for the printing of the winter issue of Chapter 1 in the amount of $6,342.49. Does anybody want any of these items removed from the consent agenda for discussion of the new business?
So in order to discuss, we have to remove them,
right?
Okay, I wanted to discuss the statement about the minutes, and then I had a couple questions about line items in the check register. So do we need to pull them out?
The check register is
So approve the minutes. I just wanted to, I have a question about the minutes under A, and then I have a question about the payment to Visio Graphic C. So we need to pull them out.
Okay, so then we'll just do them separately.
Okay.
Okay, so for the first item on the agenda.
I move to approve the payment of bills for operating expenses.
Oh, for just B?
Right.
For the B.
Just
removing the A and the C.
And I'll second that.
Okay, so then we're approving the B, the approval payments of the bills.
All of you, just the first part.
All of the minutes and the Visiograph are separate.
So it's bills for special reserve expenses.
Okay. So. So motion to approve the payment of the bills for the operating expenses of $170,089.18 payroll expenses of $292,349.57, special reserve expenses of $32,431.99, for total monthly expense of $494,870.74. So we have one move?
Karen
move. And then Barbara.
Second.
So Karen and Barbara. Okay, second. Any discussion? Okay. Can you take a vote, please?
Karen?
Yes.
Carolyn?
Yes.
Barbara?
Yes.
Linda?
Yes.
Tim?
Yes.
All right, so then if we can entertain a motion to approve the minutes of the regular board meeting of December 16th, 2015.
So moved. Second.
Any discussion?
I had a question. I would like the minutes to reflect my statement regarding, it says here, trustee Durbin asked specifically what should be included. I didn't really ask. I requested that attorney Walsh specifically state what is considered, what was his term?
A fair summary of the discussion?
Oh, yes, a fair summary of the discussion in the minutes. And the reason was because I had listened to the video 2 months ago and was unable to write down specifically what an accurate account or summary of the minutes meant. So I asked that he would just verbally state them, and the secretary would then write that statement in the minutes. So we would all have the exact wording. And we don't have that, but that was what I requested, that our attorney state that statement once again, because I was unable to hear it. And it was not in those minutes 2 months ago. And then if we can get that statement in here.
My understanding is his statement.
Yeah, the fourth statement in there.
Okay, so trustee Durbin requested that attorney Walsh specifically state what is a clear and accurate summary of minutes for us. That's what I'm meaning. It's the first page.
The first page 4.
And then after that, you can state what the statement is. Mr. Walsh said it does. Okay, so where's his exact statement?
The third sentence.
Mr. Walsh said that he thinks the minutes need to reflect a fair summary of a discussion which was held at the meeting. So that's what it is?
Yes.
Not an accurate account, including the topic.
Well, that would include a fair summary.
Okay, that's fine. So we won't have to argue about it in the future. Because remember, my concern is topics are missing. So just want to make sure when we discuss whatever, it's in here. And the degree of information is up to the secretary. So I think that's what I say. So that's all I'm asking. Is that I requested that, and the statement is in here, and that's that.
So the topics, I think, are pretty much set forth in the agenda. What are the topics there?
Conversations in a meeting usually include additional information, additional questions. That's what the topics get excluded.
I don't know, I think that's sort of ambiguous, and I don't know that we're just recording the minutes and divine what all the topics are that various people might bring up in various statements. So topics certainly could follow the agenda, because that's pretty clear. We have a written agenda, and that tells us what we're talking about. But I don't know how conversations might meander and how whoever's doing the minutes can decide what are the various topics that were hit upon during various conversations.
Well, ambiguity would mean that it's a duplication, and I don't think that's what we're searching for here. I think when Diane listens to the minutes, if I brought up a question, like I did in so many meetings about a particular purchase, or a process or a procedure, and Susan or Greg said, oh, we'll look into that, we'll, you know, I'll have so-and-so take a look at that, that would be something that should be added to the minutes, because it was an additional topic and it was discussed, and it gives us like a blueprint, so next month we could say, hey, how have we gotten there? Have we gotten anywhere with that? But it's not ambiguous.
But what I have instructed Diane to do with it, is that she has to put down who's present, what time the meeting started, anything that was voted upon, a summary of the discussion, but in particular, anything that is for guidance for us to do something. And so anytime a trustee has given us instruction on something, that goes in the minutes. But yeah, I think she did that this time. She tried very hard. I mean, she actually
had it. Oh, I
didn't
see it.
Okay.
I'm just saying that I'd like in the minutes that I requested that our attorney verbally state what that statement is about, what our minutes should reflect. And Diane put it in here and we're done. Well, I think the part you missed was that it says, Ms. Ryan asked Mr. Walsh to please repeat what he said. Okay, it was at my request we did this and everyone pretty much attacked me. So I might as well at least get it in the minutes that I requested it.
Okay.
And we're done.
So
okay?
You want your name and so my name there, Ms.
Ryan? I want my name. I wanted to say that I requested
Right, but then I did ask him then, from what you said, and then I asked him.
You can do whatever you want, but if I didn't ask, but I didn't ask specifically what should be in the minutes. I asked the attorney to specifically state the sentence so it could be in here, because it's lacking. And then I also brought up, the reason I'm asking for this is because when I viewed the video 2 months ago, because he did mention it's the same thing he said 2 months ago, that I was unable to hear him.
Right.
And you also said at that point that you would look into microphone.
Right, I asked the IT department then.
Right, so I'm just trying to...
And that was already in here too.
Right, that's, I'm just trying to give you an idea of where this conversation went. Okay, thank you, that's all I have.
Yeah, so that's all specific within that.
Okay.
Any other discussion? Okay. Then, take a vote.
Karen?
Yes.
Carolyn?
Yes.
Barbara?
Yes.
Linda?
Yes.
Tim?
Yes.
Nancy, yes, with change, correct. Thank you.
Okay, then, the last one,
Visio.
Okay, so, move to approve the payment to Visio Graphic for the printing of the winter issue of chapter one in the amount of $6,342.49.
So moved.
Second.
Karen and Tim, any discussion?
Yes, we brought this up, I think, was it the November 30th meeting? We talked about, the cost for chapter one. It's a high-end publication, and, I asked if we could look into some other options.
Yes.
And I was wondering, so this is already printed now, and there was nothing...
Oh, yeah, yeah. The deadline for that was too far away, but Sasha now is investigating, talking to other printing companies and seeing what, other pricing we can get, what the different pricing looks like for different finishes on paper, things like that.
Okay, thank you.
Any further discussion? Can you take a roll, please?
Karen?
Yes.
Carolyn?
Yes.
Barbara?
Yes.
Linda?
Yes.
Yes.
Sorry. Oh, thank you. Any public comments? Treasurer's report?
Expectations by $9,200, and we're short due today to $53,000, or 1.8%. We expect to catch up to budget expectations throughout the year as the shortfall is due to the uneven collection of real estate taxes, which we should start to see payment again on soon. For expenditures, salaries for the month are $11,007 over budget estimates, or 0.4%. Under budget, $95,000 or 6% for the year. The over budget for the month is caused by December being a 5-week pay month compared to the normal 4-week pay. So we have 24 pay periods. Each pay period covers 2 weeks of work, except four times a year. We have a 3-week, and when that's included in a month, because the budget is exactly 1/12 of the annual number, we exceed by about 0.4%, as you see here. Library materials for the month are 27.7 under budget, or 45%, 8,788 over budget, or 2.3% for the year. Again, due primarily to annual subscription fees offset by slower purchasing patterns and some of the other categories. Library operating expenses is $3,800 under budget, or 13% for the month. $31,000 under budget, or 18% for the year. It's due primarily to slower than anticipated spending in software and printing. General administrative, those expenses are $7,400 under budget, or 27% for the month.
$42,000, or 26% for the year-to-date. And this is due primarily to slow spending in the consultant line item. Seems that legal is caught up in this. Employee fringe benefits, $2,800 over budget, or approximately 5% for the month. $22,901 under budget, or 6.7% for the year. This reflects the same patterns in the salary line item. Utilities is approximately $2,000 under budget for the month and year-to-date. Finally, the debt surplus or deficit. For the month, debt deficit is $470,000, which is $46,000 favorable to the budgeted net deficit of $517,000, and $341,000 favorable, or 105% year-to-date. Do you have any questions?
The only thing that I have a question for, and with the new check detail, which actually I really liked.
Yes, thank you so much.
Do we still need the check register?
I think you do.
Yeah?
Yeah. Here's why. The check record is going to make sure it captures everything. I'm trying to capture everything with an ad hoc report. I think it's important to have both these. One report, the check register that you have been getting is a canned report that is contained in the software.
Okay.
It has, you know, been checked over and over and over again and is bug free.
Okay.
My report is
The check detail
report is drawn from certain fields in the database, which has not gone through the same rigor as the check register. So in case there's a discrepancy, I think you need the check register.
So sometime maybe if a field is missing, I got it.
Yeah.
Because I found myself not really looking at the check register.
Right.
Yeah, thank you. I mean, I'll just say.
I think both are important.
All right.
I do like the check detail report.
Yeah.
It's very good.
So that was my only. I have one question. Standard and Poor's, I didn't know that was described. So it's 9,000 a year. How many people use that? I'm just curious. I thought most companies sort of. I'm just curious. It's expensive. And by the way, the detail in this report is incredible. Thank you so very much. I do have just one question. Under account number, I was wondering if you could maybe explain, or maybe we would need a little more information. I was trying to figure out, looking at the account number, it's like 01. This is what I'm thinking. Like 01 could represent a fund, but 4413 could be a department. In your accounts numbering system, what does that refer to?
The first two digits refer to the fund number. Most of them will be 01, which indicates general fund expenditure, which is where most of our operating expenses are paid from.
Okay.
The next four places indicate an account number. So
4413.
4413 sounds like it's in the materials budget.
Okay. Is it possible to get like a little descriptor of what the budget, the account numbers are, so we know like code or whatever?
I think the report it shows right next to it.
On the right hand side it says account description.
But
so
does
it says
that,
adult books.
Does that then relate to the budget?
Yeah.
I guess that's the question. Are each one of these account descriptions a budget line item?
Yeah.
They are. Okay. So we have to look back at it. So you have the income statement, you know. On the income statement, the revenue, are these budget items that are listed in the left-hand column, are these the same as the account description? Is that how we're kind of related? Okay.
Yeah, both are the same thing.
So 4487 online database.
Now, I want you to be aware that many things impact the accounts. So this is only one source of entry. And there could be, I'm looking at the first line on page 19, lost book refund. It's just what I happen to be open to.
Sure.
There could be multiple lost book refunds throughout this report, which if you're trying to reconcile it to the profit loss statement or the income statement, you would have to find those and add it up. Plus, there may be other entries from other sources, which either make the account bigger, you know, in terms of a larger debit being charged to it, or offset it.
Right. Yeah, I guess and I don't know what Carolyn was looking for specifically, but I guess I was wanting to make sure that whatever we're paying in an account has been accounted for in the budget when we first started. You know, when we created a budget, that these account descriptions are mirrored in that budget.
We would never add another one without it being in the budget.
Right, okay. Yeah.
Yeah, you should be able to go through each month and see that, you know, the numbers in that particular column, the annual budget numbers, have not changed.
Okay.
The only ones that may change are the monthly ones. You know, because in some cases I've tried to, you know, refine the estimates based on previous year's cash flows and things of that nature. But more often than not, each month's budget is expressed as 1/12 of the annual budget, right, but the annual budget does not change. Okay. Not unless you say it changes. Or I should say, use.
Okay.
That's, this report is incredible. I'm also looking at it in terms of departments, like AV youth and adults, so it'll give me an idea of what each department's doing and then also the connection to the budget. I'm just blown away. This is awesome. Thank you so much. It's like a pleasant surprise when I open my packet.
Couple questions that I have, just a little bit, and I think it's going to be really good, I think. On page 27, of the income statement consolidated.
Yes.
Very bottom, substitutes. What are substitutes?
Substitutes are, most of them are people that used to work for the library, quit for one reason or another, but we've kept them on our books in case everybody calls in sick and you need to pull somebody in.
Okay. So
and we had, yeah, that line is overspent and they are not called substitutes anymore right now. We. The past two supervisors almost never used it, so we left that item at a low level, and then our two brand new supervisors have had a lower staffing level and a lot of people out, so they've had to cover, and so they have had to use substitutes quite a lot, but they have put the brakes on now because we have one out overspent.
All right. That's page 28, 1, 2, 3, about 6 or 7 from the bottom, public performing rights.
That is for rights? The movies.
For the movie?
Yes, movie licensing.
Okay. And on the next page, 29, somewhere lower or middle, we've got a trustee expense. But our year-to-date actual is a negative 85.
Yeah, we received some money back on for some expenditure in that item, I think, the previous year.
Oh, because I know we've spent stuff.
Yeah, we spent a small amount, yeah.
Okay, well, you're doing good. Try to get more than I get. Okay, that's all my questions. Thank you very much. Very good.
Okay, the next item on the agenda is the director's report.
All right. Well, I have to say that I got our per capita grant application in on time. The date was January 15th, and so here's a copy of it for each of you. If you turn to the last page, if you just flip it over, it tells you what we told them that we will be spending our money on. You never know exactly how much money you're going to get, so you have to leave it a little bit open-ended.
Done.
The second one, yeah, it's only 4 pages.
Yeah, it's 2 pages. So you see that what I told them, we are we will take some portion of the grant money, whatever it is, to replace some of the technology related supplies, such as the 3D printing filament. There are a number of things that you have to keep buying for things like that, holder for the printer, things like that, replacement equipment. And I also said that we might use some of that money for particular collections. And I specified some of the possibilities here, like our hot picks collection for high demand items. That's kind of fun where you can always use another James Patterson, but every time you buy another James Patterson, you're not buying something else. So this would give us a little more money for that. And then it's sort of similar to this way we're using substitutes. I have put in to use grant funds to hire temporary personnel for projects. Rather than hiring somebody, putting them on our payroll, giving them benefits, this would be to hire, say, a teacher over the summer to help out with summer reading or with our science lab. So those are the three things I said that we would be spending whatever money it is that they give to us. I did find them talking with the state library this time that they, as long as you stay within the parameters of what you said you're going to do, they are not going to be scrutinizing, how much did you spend on this? You report back to them what you spent in each category, but they're not going back and looking for anything except, there are certain things you're not allowed to buy. Like, we're not allowed to buy a replacement van out of this month, say. We're not allowed to, for some reason, buy a water cooler with this money. Very specific things that we can't do. We can't buy anything that gets attached to the wall. That becomes construction instead of furniture, so.
Can I just ask one question?
Certainly.
In terms of salary, is there, I don't know what they allow and what they don't. Because our library is implementing new technology and a lot, do they allow to cover just having someone here as a trainer? I mean, is there some way they would cover salary? I mean, I don't know what this grant really allows to do.
They would. You could put in for that. I would never want to put in anything that was a must-have position.
You might need to
it does have to be specific.
It can't be towards the cost as opposed to, I would want them to fund someone's total salary. Can they allow, would they pay 10%, 20% towards someone's salary?
Well, they'll give us a flat amount of money and we can spend that money in whatever way that we think is appropriate. It's just that some years they've given us $25,000, $50,000, $75,000. It's really, so I've tried to make it as flexible as possible so that whichever category it fell in,
you're able to use.
Okay, so that we would be able to use all of it, because you have to use every penny of this money or you don't get it the next year.
No, I understand. Oh, that makes sense.
I've never wanted to put anything in that was a vital thing. Some libraries put in things like their OCLC, which is the catalog you need for your catalog, and would never want to put us in the position of relying on the state for that.
Well, I wouldn't want to rely on the state. I would like them to fund it, a percentage of it, to help offset our costs.
But I guess the question then is, if the money didn't come through, then you budgeted, but you've lost that percentage. Now,
I'm thinking it's already in our budget, and if she could get money, that would help us spend less in that category. But I know these things are really touch and go. You don't want to go over a number.
The way that we budget them is that we'll have a line item for forget the grant expenditures. So if we're planning to put, let's say, $10,000 in salary, we use the salary line for $10,000 and increase the per capita line by $10,000, so that we're not paying that $10,000 price. So if money doesn't come through, then we have a per capita expense line item which carries that, but we're not really getting to offset that.
Right, and that's why I wanted in salaries. I would just like to see if she could somehow help us offset costs. But the other thing about submitting these applications, it's what you ask for, it's how much that determines them saying no, and I wouldn't want to jeopardize that either. It was just a question.
Yeah. Well, then I think to some extent we are doing that by putting this last thing in, the thing where you can than hiring a person that we really need. It's to try to make it a short-term, single-time expense.
So now last month they didn't come up with a date to submit, but
they had the date as January 15th, but they didn't say when they'd be telling us.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, I'm
so now
kind of not holding my breath, but.
Oh, okay. All right. I was wondering.
Okay.
No, I hear you. This is awesome. Thank you.
how long have you between the time last year?
Last year was quite fast. Last year it was.
It was in May.
Always May.
The last 2 years we received the data too.
But I guess that was October, so it wasn't super fast. So they bumped the deadline from October to January. So yeah, so I frankly anticipate that they'll just hold on to these applications and it'll actually be next year. But that's just guessing. You never know.
Yeah, this thing's kind of up there. Colin, thank you. Great idea.
Sure. Is there any other questions about the grant? Okay, you had asked for a copy of the district map. Sasha found one. It is not nearly as detailed as this district map here, but at least it's a start. So here it is, and it will be going on the website. And if we can get a more detailed one, we will, but just want to just give you the general boundaries of it. Then I wanted you to know that we are participating in this joint effort with the Skokie Public Library and a number of other libraries and organizations that is this VIVA coming together. And it's a nice collection of programs. The Skokie Public Library is the one that started it, and they focus on one particular culture every time. So this time, now they have expanded it to include other organizations. So we've been doing it for 3 years with them now, and so this one is Latino and Hispanic Cultures. And it's a really nice booklet of all the different programs. So I'm just going to send that around for you to see what we're participating in. We're not participating at nearly the same level as Skokie, but we're still keeping our hand in it.
Can I ask a question of this? Are we able to get what I was looking for were precincts and the number of people that live there that are able to come to our library when we look at, this is our library?
That's our district, yeah.
Okay, so in terms of people who don't live in the immediate Niles area, like we were talking about developing that northern section.
Yes.
How do we determine who's living there now based on these boundaries? Can we get that information?
Well, the census tract information we have, I think.
It's in the voting. It's on the voting.
Isn't it? Yeah, well, yeah, sure. I mean, if you want it by precinct, but I don't know that the precincts follow the. Well, the precincts must follow the district.
Yeah, I can find that. That's right online.
Sure.
Because then it would give us an idea of how many people we are going to service in that area.
Actually, it might just tell how many people voted last year.
Voters aren't the same as library people.
Right.
And there's a small percentage of our population that actually registered to vote.
The census would be right, because that would give family members young, because you have everyone under 18 and voters.
That wasn't what I was referring to. I was referring to the list is it just voters on those lists, or is it everyone who lives there? And then it denotes who voted in the last election.
Mm-hmm. No, it's who's registered to vote.
Okay.
You can also buy lists that tell you only who's voted in the last, or who's pulled a Republican ballot during the last election, who's pulled a ballot.
Okay.
So they will break out lists like that, but it won't really tell us
what we need to know.
We do have, Cindy has set for a map that goes in much more detail from the Cook County Clerk's office. So hopefully that will give us a lot more information about who actually lives in the district. But my understanding is that it's roughly 30,000 people in the non-Niles part, in the unincorporated areas.
Oh, in addition to the Niles.
Yeah, it's 57,000 people in all of them. 72 something.
Okay, and they're all Niles Library
district.
Okay, yeah.
I think that our district include any parts that are actually in another village, like when you...
Just mines, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. 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 Well, it's the unincorporated areas.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, they don't belong. They have the name, they have the zip code of Des Plaines or Glenview, but they are not in the municipality. Correct.
Okay.
Their taxes come to us, not to Glenview, not to Des Plaines.
Right. Okay.
I also wanted to pass this out if you wanted to talk to legislators about, encouraging them to give us our per capita money. And they always talk about this at the legislative breakfast, which I think Carolyn has been to before, but I'm not sure anybody else has. It's President's Day. So February 20th.
Oh, is that it?
It's, yeah, it's going there. Legislative breakfast is going there. It's also on your trustee calendar. And then I wanted to mention that in my written report, I talked a little bit about intergovernmental agreements. And I said that we have been notified by the state library that the way we are handling our teacher cards is not correct, and that what we need to do is develop an intergovernmental agreement with our schools. So I am going to need to get information for you on that and come up with some ideas of some kind of an agreement that we could give, make with them, and then work with Dennis on developing an intergovernmental agreement. And I see three areas in which we need intergovernmental agreements, particularly with District 63. One is so that the teachers can have teacher cards, and that so that those books are getting in the hands of their students. We do make deliveries to them, and then they check out here. But we've been doing that for many years, and it's very much appreciated service, but apparently we're not handling it the way you're supposed to. You're supposed to have to make an agreement with the school district. Second thing is that the TLC group that does the after-school programming up there, he was talking about turning one of his spaces into a library, and I said that that would be something we would like to work with him on. That would be another thing that would require an intergovernmental, the director of of TLC.
But that was a woman.
She just retired, and now there's a new real dynamo of a director he wants to do. His name is Brian Williams, and I will be meeting with the foundation board next week, so I can talk with them more about that. But I just wanted to kind of give you an early heads up that this was something that you would start hearing a little bit about.
Would that be a library within one of the District 63 schools?
Yeah, they have a trailer over at Apollo School, and he was talking about, you know, using some of the foundation funds to buy books and things. I'm like, that's kind of ridiculous. When we're talking about trying to get some service up there, that would be a really easy way to get some service up there. We have a teen center collection right now at Gulf Mill that, that is centered there, so we could do something similar with them. But because it's a school, it would have to be an intergovernmental agreement.
Where is District 63?
District 63 is the north end of the district. It's Mark Twain School, Washington School,
Nelson,
Apollo, Stevenson, and
Gemini and Melzer. Okay, they do not have tax dollars in their school budget for a library.
This is a foundation.
They actually do have school libraries. Yeah. So this would be in addition to that. This would be for just for the after-school kids.
Okay.
So
is it TLC?
TLC, right.
Total Learning Center or something like that.
Community.
Yeah.
Is that a private?
It's a foundation.
No, yeah.
It was spun off from District 63 maybe 10, 15 years ago. And they do a lot of stuff.
They do a lot of Saturday programming in schools.
They also incorporate Culver, District 61.
Right.
71 right across the street.
Yeah, they also work with Culver. Yeah, at their summer program, they said they had 20 kids from 27 different schools participating. So.
And that's approximately where is it?
It's on D Road off of Central.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so up there. It's way up there.
Okay.
Yeah, a lot of unincorporated displays up there. It's a little bit of a poorer area. It's a lot of people, kids that don't have computers and things like that.
Can I ask you just to give us a little more detail on the fact that we are not compliant with dealing with schools?
Just how we're issuing our teacher cards, that we were having them fill out teacher card applications and working directly with them rather than making an agreement with the school. And it's a change to the way the state has modified their regulations. So we're just going to have to get in compliance with it.
Okay, so the state is telling us.
Yes, it's the state telling us.
I just wondered, like, all of a sudden, Niles Library is doing something.
Oh, it's not just us. Not just us, definitely.
Yeah. So these are library cards that teachers
use.
So then it doesn't matter where they live, obviously.
Exactly, that's exactly
right. Teach in the district is the idea.
That's exactly right.
Do we do anything for anybody else that lives in the district, or is our teachers the only people there?
Business people might be in that same position where they own a business in the district but they live somewhere else, so their card might appear as being like somebody from Buffalo Grove, but it's their business that's located here. Yeah. And then the third area in which we might want to develop an intergovernmental agreement is that there are a few students up there that do not belong to any library district. They are what is called the unserved. Their parents 20 years ago voted against becoming part of the library district. So they are not paying taxes to anyone, but Many, many times people move into the house not having any idea that they are not part of the library district. And so what some libraries around the state, what the state is very much encouraging libraries to do is to make intergovernmental agreements with schools to get those students' library cards. So it would be the school would have to come up with some benefit to the library in exchange for our giving those kids library cards. And it would have to be a very restricted card where they were not able to use it at other libraries and it would be just for the children. But that's something that you would I would have to get very specific numbers for you on that before I would bring that to you.
Because isn't that usually a monetary fee?
Yes, normally somebody would be coming in and paying an on-resident card fee, which is $300.
Right.
Yes.
Right.
Yeah. So that's, of the three things, I think that I can see where the board may be a little reluctant to do that third one. So I have to find out exactly how many students we're even talking about. I think they'd have to vote, or the Village of Niles.
This is like the whole point of living there, since you don't have to pay those fees.
Yeah, but I, you know, maybe that's because some people didn't really realize that.
No, I'm sure they didn't. Yeah, a lot of people didn't, because they're so surprised when they come in. They have no idea that they weren't paying taxes to the library. There are pockets. I can get you that information for next month. They're mostly unincorporated Glenview. These kind of swirly streets. That's kind of the best I can.
So it's the other side of Gaul.
Yeah, exactly. It's right near Washington School. And so that's the particular school that feels the impact of it a lot.
Okay.
So they have been, you know, they really, really want to work with the library. They want us to sign all of their kids up for summer reading this year, which is great. But they know that some of their kids don't have library cards at all. And their parents don't have the ability to pay for a library card anymore. So let's see. I think that was all. Do you have any questions for me?
No, but we do have that also with Main South and Main Cross. Okay. But I know Des Plaines doesn't let us do it.
Des Plaines? Because that's a municipal library. That's a municipal. We're
right.
The only district.
But Park Ridge does.
Park Ridge was the designated.
For a specific
one.
Amount of
yeah.
money, we have to pay the library for those. Students,
yeah.
a certain amount of money for them to be able to
use
the library.
That's interesting. So we should talk more about that.
But I know I went and spoke to Des Plaines. Why not?
They
do
it. They kind of can't because
of yeah. If I'm remembering it correctly, there. You know, we have two different positions. Now you know I have some notes on.
Okay.
Okay. That's all I have for that.
I don't know if this is an appropriate time, it says communications, can I make a verbal communication? I just want to say that I recently had occasion to use the equipment downstairs to review, to look at old slides, and I took out a flash drive, and it was very interesting, and I really enjoyed doing that. A surgeon downstairs helped me, he helped me take these slides, which were taken in the 1940s, and which our family has not been able to see for decades, and to actually convert them and put them on a flash drive, and we've been able to see them for the first time in many, many years. So it was really wonderful to be able to do that. And other family members and I, you know, and them too are thrilled and happy.
That's great. I'm really glad to hear that. Yeah, we are getting a lot of compliments for the staff down there because they're so proactive and really, really willing to help. In fact, I was realizing that we give you all of our written comments every month. That Diane types up, but you don't see the comments that are ones that get given to the circulation people as people are leaving the library. Sometimes they get comments too. So I was thinking I should start adding those to this list so you get a fuller list of what people are saying about us.
I get comments of the jewels.
I'd love to hear those too, especially the good ones.
The monthly statistical report.
Yes.
We don't have
it had a big boo-boo in it, so that's why you have a revised version of it.
I make big boo-boos of it. Can we get a, we don't have a count of the MakerBot or the use of the...
It's under equipment. It's under equipment.
First page.
Yes. So under loan and material by type, it's just people counting it as equipment. It's not separated out. And certainly, I think Susie does give me that information every month, so I think I could get that separated out for you and put that in the report. Or put it.
On page 46, is that the first page?
Yep.
And equipment is.
Under motive material, under the blue. There's another adult equipment where there were 74 uses. Teen had seven, and juvenile does not have anything that they're doing like that.
Here, I think this is. Yeah, it would be interesting to know. I mean, I don't want to make more work for anybody, but.
Oh, they have all the stats.
I get comments about the digital media land a lot from people. Very positive.
Good.
In the jewel. It would be interesting to see how the recording studio is being used.
Yeah, I would be happy to get that to you.
Now, since he brought up NaturePod, is that what it's called? I think I saw it when I was reading the library the other day.
It's the thing that's up at the top of the stairs.
The stairs, right?
Yes.
Okay, yeah. If somebody was, something was being made and it said it had another hour and 45 minutes to go.
It takes a long time.
So does it?
Yeah.
And I was wondering, in the course of a day, how many times would you make something? I mean, is it used that often?
It's going pretty much continuously as far as I can tell. Yeah, just about.
And I was going to wait and I thought, and then I saw an hour and 45 minutes, like, I'm out of here, I gotta go.
Yeah, well, I mean, normally you would send digital services the job that you have and it goes in the queue and they handle all of that. So you don't, patrons don't handle it directly themselves.
Okay, because it had already been in one hour and 1 minute. I'm like, okay, well, that's this. I won't be here to see it.
Yeah.
So then you give the patrons a call then later? The thumb is ready or how?
I think they email generally, but yeah, and they tend to.
Email.
Yeah, they go. Yeah, and then they come by and pick it up, have a shop down there, or they keep everything that's finished.
Well, I've gotten positive comments from them.
Wonderful.
I appreciate the calendar.
Communications, yeah.
Oh, good.
Appreciate the calendar.
Excellent.
That's very good.
Good. So on communications, I just wanted to call your attention to, on page 51, we had an article written by our team librarian, Donna Block, about our, highlighting our project Playbill that she's been doing for a number of years here. So that was cool. We also got a nice letter from the mayor thanking one of our children's librarians for helping with Holly Jolly, and then one of our adult librarians, the one that runs our book discussion groups down here, and that's still for somebody. And then the last one, page 55, is actually addressed to you trustees. This one from the African American Contractors Association. It is inviting you as the elected officials to attend a particular event.
Omar Sharif, isn't he in the
Omar Sharif is not there.
Is he still alive?
I was getting excited about it.
I thought he was dead.
I don't know. Came
back. I'm excited that we get a national red carpet treatment.
I know.
There you go. So.
VIP.
Is there an address on that?
There is
the first paragraph. It just says at the South Shore Drive.
I think they mean the South Shore Club, but I don't really know. This is
there's no address yet.
Yeah.
They don't really want to see
it. It's not really good information.
Just wanted to be sure that you noticed that you've been invited to something.
I work at first.
That's all my opinions.
Okay. So the next item on the agenda is the liaison reports. So, friends of the library room?
We did not have a meeting this month. It was canceled.
Oh, okay.
Our next one is February, the second Monday of February.
February?
Is that it?
Friends of the library?
Is it on?
Right.
Anyway, so far, so good. If it doesn't
start,
I love this. Thank you.
Legislative?
Nothing yet. No.
And Rails?
No.
Okay. Secretary's report. There's no secretary's report. New business. I will entertain a motion to approve the expenditures of special reserve funds in the amount of and not to exceed $58,142.65 for the purchase of 55 patron desktop computers.
So move the motion.
I'll second. Zipper?
Right.
Susan, can you tell us about the purchase, please?
I'm going to ask Greg and Rich to handle that because they have done all the legwork on this.
So we have, we currently have 71 computers existing that are patron facing. We need to add two more in the teen center, so 71 plus 2 is 73. We are removing 9 computers, and we are retaining old equipment in the catalog positions, because it's just a view into our catalog. You know, the requirements aren't real high. So that's 18. So 73 minus 18 is 55 computers, which are left to be distributed into the tech level, downstairs, children's area, and the teen area right now. And then we also buy one for the computer center. So if there's changes or a new ghost image or something like that to test, we can have a unit to test that. So that's it. We're spending a little over $1,000, $1,064 per unit for 40 of the units. And for the 15 units, they're going to a kid space. We're spending $1,037.91. The purchase price represents a 54% discount from Dallas list price. Last time we made this purchase, 6, 7, 8 years ago, whatever it was, we had a 43% discount. And the pricing, the net pricing to us was very similar to when we bought it all those years ago. And again, just like the last computer purchase that we approved last month, this is done under a cooperative purchasing agreement. So it's all pre-bid. You know, they went out and made that prices, and it meets the state requirements for site purchases.
Any discussion?
Do you have room for all these? You're going to get that? We purchased what, 28 or something last time?
We purchased 20 laptops, so they should be deployed before we get these.
Oh, okay.
What we're actually doing here is we're buying the boxes, but we're not buying the flat screens,
right?
The monitors.
Right.
So we'll continue to use the monitors, and we'll replace them as they fail.
Can you kind of talk about
sure.
Where are these purchases fit on this graph that we see here?
Yeah, absolutely.
So, last month,
reading left to right,
mm-hmm.
The first item up at the top left corner, purchase Studio B computers for $32,000, that was the 20 laptops. They're actually more than just Studio B computers. They're intended, because of their mobility with the cart, to be used throughout the library, so they have multiple uses. The next line below is the purchase of the patron computers, which is what we're talking about right now.
And that's 32 units.
No, it's 55 units.
I mean, 32 plus 15.
I'm sorry.
Plus 7, right? Is that what we're looking at?
And then we have one more purchase to come. Which, if you read out to the right in the late April time frame, is the staff computers.
And how many do we think that'll be?
Right now it looks around 71, but we're still looking at the laptops and that.
So we anticipate 71 computers at an estimated cost of $90,000. They're going to primarily be desktops. And for traveling and for going homes, supervisors typically have access to a laptop, and we're trying to figure out how to best do that without carrying too much equipment.
Any questions?
Yeah.
I have just one question. Included in these costs, is there some sort of
maybe not warranty, but who will be taking care of the computers? Do these come with any type of?
They generally come with a 3-year warranty.
Do they?
Yeah, and we buy the warranty up to 5 years.
Okay, so you do that.
Yeah.
Okay, I didn't see it and I didn't know how you were. Is it included in this?
Yeah, I think it's very, the detail on the quote.
That's okay, it is in here now, okay.
It's itemized on the last part of the quote.
Oh, I know, and I'm reading like line by line and, oh, you mean in the paragraph section?
Yeah, so if you look at page 60.
Okay.
For the bottom. Looks like one of the bottom three lines there, it says pro support, next business day, outside 5 years.
Okay, there you go. All right, I saw Dell Limited Hardware plus service, I'm going, is that all we're getting? Okay, no, but I didn't go further down. Perfect, okay, thank you.
Any other questions?
Thank you.
I have one question. Okay, so just tell me if I heard it right. So you're, for the May purchase for the staff computers, you're talking about replacing 71 desktop computers around.
Yeah.
And also getting additional laptops for supervisors that are going home?
Laptops, I think, are included in the 71, is that correct?
They're currently not. Those are the
worst.
Okay.
We're considering how best to serve needs for off-site computing for supervisors who, for example, maybe go to a conference or staff members who go to a conference. Or if we're behind a project and we need to talk to a company for whatever reason. So we haven't committed, to giving everybody a laptop and a desktop. We're trying to
figure it out.
Yeah, trying to, and we have, this purchase isn't going to be Facebook up there.
Right. Okay. I wasn't sure if there was two per person here.
I'd like one is not.
All right. So that's still up for discussion.
Yeah.
And review. Okay. All right. Just got it. That's all my only question. Anyone else have any questions? No? Okay. All right. Then the next item on the agenda is a discussion of.
I know we didn't take the roll.
Oh, so sorry. Okay, Karen, please take a roll.
Karen,
I'm moving along.
Yes.
Carolyn?
Yes.
Annette? I'm sorry.
Barbara?
Yes.
Linda?
Yes.
Yes.
Thank you. All right. Now, the next agenda item is a discussion of the strategic planning process. Susan, do you have any ideas regarding the strategic plan?
Yeah, I wanted to start getting some ideas from you guys of what kind of a strategic planning process you want to take on. You can do something that is, last year when you were looking for a new library director and the consultant said that you needed to have some kind of a strategic plan that you could talk about with the candidates, and we came up with some kind of quick strategic goals. That's one approach that's basically just the supervisors talking amongst themselves and saying these are all things that we think are important. That's not a very thoughtful approach. That's a very, very quick and dirty approach. You could have something more like what we did 6 years ago where we hired a consultant and all of the trustees and all of the supervisors and administrative staff work together with the trustee, with the consultant on developing a strategic plan. That was a considerably more detailed plan, and it took about 6 months, and then we had a plan that was good for 5 years, but it is now, that was literally 6 years ago. I found the binder on it, and it was a full 6 years ago that we did that. So that's a long time to go between strategic plans. And then there's another possibility. Our neighbors down the street in Skokie are doing a very, very extensive strategic plan where they have sent a number of their staff off to be trained at the Harwood Institute for thousands of dollars per person to learn more about how to talk to the community and get good results working together with the community. And they spent 6 months getting ready to do their strategic planning, and now they're getting ready to do their strategic planning. So that's the spectrum. It's kind of the quick and dirty, the kind of more middle of the road, or the very full kind of process, which quite frankly I cannot quite envision going quite that far down the road as Skokie has, but I'm sure they will come up with a pretty fantastic plan. That director's getting ready to retire, and I think she just really wants to make sure that they have a very, very solid plan for the future.
one of these old folders, you know, I've always kept these old folders because I kept a lot of stuff. And I actually kept all the stuff from when we did our last strategic plan here.
I was just looking through that today.
I was thinking that, you know, last time we hired a consultant, but I was thinking that with all these materials, we could really do this ourselves.
That certainly is.
I mean, not the board, but I mean,
right.
You and the staff, and the supervisors. I mean, I've got here all the suggested PLA service responses. Here's how to get your focus groups in the community. It's just everything, it's a recipe for doing a strategic plan. So
it is.
If
it
you
is.
Have all this, that's fine, or you can borrow this and look at it and.
And no, I have that, as well. I was just looking at it today. And
okay.
Also, Cindy and I went to a workshop on doing strategic, it was called Strategic Frameworks. And it was, it had a slightly different approach, but it was one where you first do what he called appreciative inquiry, where you look at what your library is doing well. And you try to look at what's working and why is it working, and then how could you extend things that are working well to be good at other things. And it's the idea of it is that you come up with basically sort of three general categories of things that you're working toward, and then you would keep looking at it every month to see where you are on it. And then, you know, we were thinking we have a number of tools where we can gather some of the data that we would need for this. It's really partly just a matter of how much time the board themselves wants to put into this, because I do feel like it's a very important part of it to have board support and board input. It really, it needs to be your plan together with us, because it definitely is going to be driving the budget in the future, and it's really, I think it's really important, and I think it needs to be done thoughtfully.
Maybe we can have special meetings just to address the strategic.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So I was really not anticipating coming out, you know, with an order to go start doing something. I have prepared some survey questions and I've started working on this a little bit, but I just kind of wanted to start to get a sense of what the board was interested in.
Well, how does this relate to...
Oh, wait, Tim, I'm sorry.
Sure.
Karen.
Oh, I'm sorry.
It's okay. It's okay.
I didn't see that.
Sorry.
What I just want to say is that I would like to involve the community in some way, which is maybe what the community wants to do, but I would really like to hear more about how it was done last time, because
okay.
I wasn't here at that time. And I'm just well, or
when,
I
you know,
heard, or you could just sort of tell us, or you
well,
know,
it's too much to tell in 25 words or less. So
okay. How about if at the next meeting, since we're missing two trustees right now, and I think the only people that were here for it last time were you two, right? So, how about at the next meeting, I give you a good overview of what the process was last
mm-hmm.
time, and that what some of the tools that we currently have that we could be using.
Okay.
Got your question.
Go ahead.
How does this relate to what the consultants did last year? I mean, we spent $60,000 or something last year.
Well, Matrix has information that
yeah,
may be helpful.
Okay.
Yes.
So
yeah, that
I
definitely would
to,
be.
Again, spend X
right.
amount of dollars on another consultant to do
yeah.
maybe work that they've already done.
Yeah, but definitely we could use
so
some of the material
yes.
that they generated, no
mm-hmm.
question about that.
Okay.
Yeah, they did like some comparisons with other libraries.
Mm-hmm.
That,
last time the consultants had us do a Saturday afternoon at White Eagle, and you remember everybody in the board, and
yep,
that was quite expensive. Mm-hmm. But I mean, now that we went down that path, we know how to do it.
Well, I think
so.
you do need to do something that where everybody is giving up a few hours and really talking
right,
something.
Right.
Yeah,
just,
yeah,
so
that's great.
We don't need
yeah.
a consultant to do it for this time.
Yeah. Yeah.
Matrix was really tactically focused, you know, basically, you know, benchmarking operations, for example, how many people we have on staff. This is more strategically focused in terms of what are we, what is the library doing that the community doesn't want, or what is the library not doing that the community does want, and one way or another, how do you see the industry, if you will, evolving. You know, in terms of you know, technology and funding, you know, things of that nature, you know, whatever the you know service levels are, and you know, things of that nature. So, you know, one is you know day to day, and the other one is longer range.
So, if you don't mind, I'd like to show you this 8-minute video that is from United for Libraries, which is the Association of Library Trustees.
Can I ask a quick question
sure.
before I move on? Is it possible, I thought I read the strategic plan, but like a cover letter that had something to do with some old strategic plan, which seems to be what you're talking about. Do we still have that?
I have all the information.
There's like a cover letter and identified what your strategic plan was, and it didn't sound like it was. It was called your strategic plan. It was paragraph.
I think that is the strategic plan. That's at the beginning of the policy manual.
Yes.
Yeah. So I can bring that next time if you want to see what the old plan was.
And that was written by a consultant.
By us working together with a consultant.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. So we could see. Okay.
Sure.
That'd be great.
Yeah. What we've
Thank
done
you.
In the past.
Okay.
So this one gives you some tips on what their recommendations are for tackling a strategic planning process.
Welcome to Short Takes for Trustees. I'm Beth Connell, the Director of Marketing and Communications for United Libraries. We are the division of the American Library Association for Trustees, Advocates, Friends, and Foundations. I'm here today speaking with our Executive Director, Sally Gardner-Reed, and we'll be talking about strategic planning. So Sally, let's talk about strategic planning. What role do library trustees play in this important endeavor?
Well, very often, trustees will actually initiate the planning process. Most library agencies will require that libraries engage in the strategic planning process every 3 to 5 years in order to receive state aid, because they recognize how important the process is. And in our rapidly changing environment these days, it's incredibly important. We know things like the economy, demographics, and technology especially are causing
I'm sure she'd be so thrilled to be caught in
We know things like the economy, demographics, and technology especially are causing major changes in the library world. And speaking of technology, I'd like to say a word about the EDGE initiative. This is an initiative that was started by the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation and led by the Urban Libraries Council. And it was a way for trustees and librarians to work with technology in the planning process. And even though it was led by the Urban Libraries Council, they used pilot sites of small and rural libraries as well as suburban libraries. So it really covers all sizes of public libraries. And what I think is especially wonderful about it is it really shows trustees, especially, how to use this EDGE initiative to make the case for technology in libraries for economic development, lifelong learning, success in school, and how to make the case for funding. It also includes tools for assessment, training, setting benchmarks, and for engaging community in the planning process. So it is a wonderful tool, and we've included a bibliography for the EDGE initiative in our resources, which you will be sharing with our viewers at the end of this particular webcast. So it's a wonderful opportunity for the planning process.
It definitely sounds like an excellent place for trustees to start. But tell me, are there particular and separate roles for the trustees and the administration and staff in the planning process?
Yes, actually there are, and they're very similar to the other sorts of roles that we've talked about before, where the trustees have a higher sort of outreach, looking out toward community, and the director and his or her staff sort of manage the process. And I would like to also say parenthetically that this is a great role for advisory boards as well as governing boards. So the boards will be engaging community, and they will be talking about the planning process to community. But meanwhile, as the planning process starts, we start with the environmental scan, and the director and his or her staff will be doing most of the legwork. They will be setting up surveys and focus groups. They will be doing community interviews. They will be looking at library use statistics and pulling those together. Then we'll probably be talking with the planning department within their community to find out what's happening with population changes. Or is the town growing? Is it declining? Are more families growing, coming in? What are the demographic changes? What are the predictions for change? So they will be pulling all that information together and creating sort of executive summaries to help trustees do the assessment process in the planning process.
So now, is this the time when trustees get more involved?
It is. It's the great time for trustees to become involved, and it's really the most exciting part, I think. While this environmental scan is going on, the trustees should hopefully be involved with engaging community, setting up the opportunity for VIPs in town to become involved, people from the planning department, perhaps from the city council, maybe the mayor, other stakeholders for the library's success should be involved and invited to help set the vision and the goals for the library. So once the staff has put together these executive summaries from the environmental scan, the trustees can hold what we call a charrette and bring these important stakeholders together and spend a day or a half a day discussing where the library is currently, where the community is currently, and where the library needs to go to best meet the needs of the community. And everybody has an opportunity to discuss what would make the library successful and help the community be successful in the next 3 to 5 years. It's a really wonderful time. So at the end of the day, with all of this information, the trustees set the vision for the library direction and set the goals for the library, and then hand off the plan for the staff and for the director to manage the strategies and implementation to realize that vision and goals.
Wait, so you're saying that the trustees don't actually have any part in setting the strategies?
No, they actually don't. That's a management job for sure. So, for example, imagine that one of the goals is that new families are moving into the community, and yet the surveys have shown they don't know about the children's story hours and children's services. So one of the goals that have been set for the plan is that youth services will grow 10% over the next 3 years, for example. And perhaps one of the trustees says, well, you know, I was talking to Mabel over at the AMP, and she told me that really story times need to be on Thursday afternoons, not in the mornings as they currently are. And the trustees say, yeah, that's a good idea. Let's move them to Thursday afternoons. And a year goes by and story times are in the afternoons, but the attendance drops. Because guess what? Kids are asleep in the afternoons. So who's going to be held accountable for that drop in children's use of the library? It's not the trustees. It's the staff. And the staff are the ones who are trained and understand and know how people use the libraries and what works best for children's services. So it's important for the trustees to let the strategies be developed by the staff, and then hold the staff accountable for how well they work towards those goals. I know that's a silly example, but I think it shows you who's ultimately going to be held accountable for the success of the meeting that goal.
So in the end, you're saying that the trustees initiate the planning process, they engage the community in that process, they participate in the assessment of the environmental scan. And then they work with the administration to set the vision and the goals, and they leave the strategy setting to the administration, the library director, and his or her staff. Is there any other role in the planning process for the trustees?
Absolutely. The trustees should be monitoring the advancement of progress towards the achievement of those goals on a monthly basis. So there should be room on the agenda every month meeting to discuss with the director how well those goals are moving along, how well the strategies are lending themselves to the achievement of those goals. And the trustees can work with the director in modifying the goals or the direction as needed as the environment changes each month, so that there's assurance that at the end of the planning process, there is success.
Thank you, Sally, for that helpful and interesting discussion about the strategic planning process, and I hope that our viewers have learned some helpful tips for their next strategic planning process. And for our viewers, we've provided a list of resources which your director will hand. So just a quick discussion of, to get you thinking about it a little bit, and then next month I will, thanks to Barbara, come up with, I'll give you our previous plan and tell you what the process was to get to that plan. Any other information I have gathered by then.
Is the next thing the retirement?
Okay.
All right, next on the agenda is a review of our current retirement offering. The Niles Public Library District is continuing its study of the library's retirement offering to its full-time employees, which began in October 2015. For the next several months, there will be a reoccurring agenda item for the regular monthly meetings of the Board of Trustees, Library Retirement Plan Investigation. Under this agenda item, the board plans to review retirement plan options, including the current plan offering and the pension plan offering by the Illinois Municipal Retirement Fund, IMRF, among other alternatives which board members and staff may bring to the attention of the board. The board's intention is to elevate the library's retirement plan offering so that it is no longer one of the bottom tier plans in the area, and to aid the library and its mission to provide over-the-top service to the residents of the Niles Public Library District and its patrons by retaining expert librarians at the district. The board expects that it will vote on a new retirement plan offering in time to implement the new retirement plan offering on July 1st, 2016. So, would you like to go ahead with what you just passed out?
Yes. You, a few months ago, had a representative of ICMA here, and it occurred to me that that was a little bit of cart before a horse there, because we didn't actually explain to you what the current plan is, and Karen had asked for a written explanation of what our current plan is. So this just tells you exactly what is done right now, so that you will have it for future use if you need it. It includes the life insurance, short-term disability, and long-term disability, because those are part of IMRF. So this is all one big umbrella here. And then the bottom part gives you information that I don't believe you have had before, telling you exactly how many people. I used the January 15th, Greg used the January 15th payroll, and he calculated that there are 38 people receiving deferred comp. 20% of them deposited the entire, 20 of them deposited the entire amount into their ICMA plan. 5 split between ICMA and getting it as additional salary, and 13 took the entire amount as additional salary, so not tax deferred at all. So 64% of the total dollars toward this go into retirement, and 36% are being taken as salary. So that is our current plan as it stands right now.
To sort of agree on what terms we're going to use for different things. I mean, for instance, when I hear the term deferred comp, to me, that means a 457 claim. And that's not how that's used here in this paragraph, in the second paragraph.
Okay.
You're talking about, I believe, just the 7.5% that you offer, which a person could put into some type of tax deferred vehicle or could take a salary.
Right. So, well, it is called our retirement benefit, and it is taxed. It's on the tax bill as pension, just to further muddy the waters. Yeah, but this is our retirement benefit. Right. That's what it's being called. But you don't want it to be called deferred comp.
Well,
that's strictly 457?
I just don't want us to get confused.
Sure.
About
no, I'm trying to be as clear as possible. So.
Yeah.
You know, even though there's some inconsistency in your mind about the definition, how we're using the term, it does reflect how we're budgeting for it. So we have a budget line item called deferred compensation, which includes the full amount, the 64% plus the 36% on the budget and therefore the financial statements.
But if 36% is being taken as pay, that's not really deferred.
It's not really deferred at all.
We agree.
Okay.
We agree.
All right.
But the way that it's budgeted and accounted for, just so you know, that the full amount, the 100%, the $36.64 appear in the line item called deferred comp in the financial statements.
So we'll be, when we do decide on this, we'll be deciding at 44 staff. Because right now we've got 38 and 64.
And there will be, yes, there are some people that are in the one-year window right now where they are not getting it.
So only 44.
But 44 after those six.
We have 44 full-time employees.
Oh, I thought you had more than 44.
Well, we have roughly, I think it's 68 full-time equivalents, which includes prorated portions of each part-time person. Okay. But we have 44 true full-time employees who are here a minimum of 37.5 hours a week that are therefore covering this program.
That was the number I was looking at.
Okay, thanks.
So, how many part-time people do we have?
I think our total census is right about 102.
Wow. So it's mostly.
Yeah. You know, some of those folks work, you know, 15 hours, which is equivalent to 2 days a week. Some of them work 20 to 25 hours a week, and you know, there's all sorts of, you know, variation depending on the department that they're in or the regularity of their schedule and so forth.
Do part-time employees participate in any?
They do not.
None whatsoever.
No.
So, because it's not a, they can't voluntarily contribute to whatever this, So is it a 457 that you have now?
Yes.
Or they cannot voluntarily contribute?
Nobody's asked.
Okay, just a thought.
Aunt Cassie was a real promoter of that. She wanted us to be able to participate in each kind of thing.
I don't know the specific answer to that, but you know, the difference between part-time and full-time is that part-time would be, part-timers would be fully funding any contributions.
Right.
Out of their pre-tax pay into this way.
Correct. And those, you know, in the future, if we decide to, I don't know what we're going to come up with ultimately, but if we end up with a custom package, maybe we can get part-timers participate. I don't know.
Yeah, I think it's all based on, you know, the if there's an agreement, you know, what the agreement looks like and what it says.
Do we know if IMRF accepts part-time?
IMRF accepts employees at either 600 hours plus annually or 1,000 hours plus annually. So 1,000 hours would be equivalent to 20 hours a week, by the average.
Okay, did you say 600 plus or 600?
I said 600 is the floor.
Okay.
So 600, 601, et cetera, all the way up to 1,950, which is the full-time year. Or, if we choose, it's $1,000 and above.
Oh, there's two separate.
Well, it's basically a plan choice.
What's the number,
450? 457.
457.
It's actually code section 457B.
So it's either the plan starts with 600 or it starts with 1,000. They don't take both.
Right. Well, I mean, if it takes 600,
then
if 600 is a floor, then it doesn't.
It gets that, okay. Because I know 600 it's a benchmark for school districts, and I didn't know at 600 hours they were able to contribute into IMRF. But
well,
I
what we've asked IMRF to do the cost study on is over $1,000.
Okay.
And back when ICMA came, they said the 457 plan was more of a savings plan and not a pension plan, so.
Right.
Just what I'm thinking is they probably would say yes, you could put some of your money in just because it's more of a savings.
Yeah,
I mean, I know
I see
presumptuous.
Investment.
I see me as not investing.
Oh, they do.
Yep.
Oh, right.
It's saving in the sense that it's a defined contribution plan where employees decide how much up to federally prescribed limits to put into the plan.
Okay, that's true.
Once it gets into the plan, there's, I believe, there's 21 or 22 different fund choices, which are typically Vanguard sponsored funds because they tend to be a low cost provider.
That's one I've heard of, I know that.
And they have all the different investing styles, you know, so different types of equity funds, different type of fixed income funds, different types of what they call lifestyle funds, in terms of if you plan to retire at 2045 or something like that.
Right, right.
You can target those.
So we think IMRF is not invested that way?
IMRF is a $37 billion fund, which is large enough for them to basically create their own mutual life funds based on style and sector. So, I mean, they, you know, at those levels, you can kind of create your own fund to have, you know, what to chase whatever statistics you're chasing.
Okay. Yeah, which make it more lucrative and probably more positive.
At the individual investor level, below $37 billion, you have a choice of basically prepackaged mutual funds that are available to the population in general.
Okay. You know, a few years ago, we compared retirement plans ad nauseum. And I still have this comparison sheet, and one of the, as long as we're talking about the current plan, it says that one of the disadvantages or one of the cons about the current plan is that employees must make investment decisions that they feel unqualified to make. You know, they're librarians, they're not accountants, they're not financial planners. So, just
well, that was
I guess I thought I'd bring it up.
That would apply to any employee.
Well, except IMRF.
Well,
right. But IMRF, on the other hand, wasn't there a concern about the portion? I mean, there's a definitive amount of money the employee needs to contribute, and there's no getting around that.
Right? Yeah, 4.5%.
And that seemed to have been problematic for a lot of people. 4.5% is like a couple hundred dollars a month. That we're thinking?
Well, I mean, it depends on your, salary level.
So
if your salary level is $1,000 a month, you know, 4.5% would be like $45.
I still hear all the comments from all the employees about whether or not we should go to IMRF. And at the time, most of the employees wanted to go to IMRF. I would suggest that we, after we review all these plans, that we survey the employees again.
How old was that?
Three years,
something like
that. You know, we were planning on talking with the staff, but after we get the results from IMRF, so that they know exactly what money we're talking about.
I'm just saying,
we want it to
save
be very
all this
realistic
stuff because it's historical and here it is in black and white.
So they will speak to the employees individually, and each employee will know.
Well, they'll have a written statement, and then that would talk about themselves specifically, and then the owner can get a chance to speak.
Oh, good. So they will be aware of what's coming out of their paycheck.
Right. Oh, yeah. Probably. Oh, okay. Yes. So I didn't want to start asking the staff now because it would be based on not specific information.
Oh, no,
so I thought you can have IMRF come and talk to you about the general plans without the results of it, but I didn't want to bring them and talk to the staff until they had the concrete information in their hands.
Yep.
That'll probably be sort of late March, early April.
And Barbara, in response to the con that, you know, they're making investment decisions that they don't feel well, our current rep, George Pantazis, who came and presented to us, has done a tremendous job trying to reach out and engage people who are participating in the plan to help them make those decisions. Yeah, so I mean, it's the old style that used to be, you're on your own, and you know, the trend, in the industry trends, there's more and more outreach and education.
Well, I think he gives you information about low risk, high risk, yeah, medium, all of that, but if you want them to be investing the money for you and placing it, you actually have to pay money for that.
Retirement target date fund was, you know, actually try to do that as a proxy. So you peg a retirement date, you know, let's say 2045 or something like that, and the, maybe not that. And it invests as if you're going to retire 2045, which means that over time it modifies the asset allocation. So
I just wanted you to have the facts and figures of what we currently are doing and something in writing that you can have then when we're talking about it later.
It's very handy.
Do you ever have anyone who asks if they can support more than 7.5% in ICMA that is not just the additional retirement benefit provided by the library, but some of their districts?
Yes.
Okay, and it's acceptable to people to do that.
Right? Yes, yeah. Okay. So to give you some real numbers, there looks to be about $4,200 that out of the $6,600 that is given by the library that goes into the ICMA per payroll, and we actually transmit in the neighborhood of $7,800, which means that the 78 less the 42 is 3,600. So we have about $3,600 in voluntary contributions that people make in the month of the 7.5%.
Okay.
And that's twice a month. That's twice a month.
Are you done? I'm sorry.
No, go ahead.
When we decide which way we're going, do we need to only have one, like only IMRF? Is it mandatory if you have IMRF, you can also have a 457?
Many organizations have one or two additional choices beyond IMRF of those that belong to IMRF. So you can have IMRF along with a 457 plan, a 457, or maybe a 403B plan, which is more of an insurance plan, like for annuities and things of that nature.
And that would be in conjunction with IMRF, or those employees who would fall under the category, whatever you choose for IMRF?
Yeah, I mean, yeah, but generally speaking, the organization focuses on IMRF because it's a large expense, and the additional savings plan would be for people, employees who want to save more than what IMRF is going to do.
Okay, and that would be totally an employee contribution. We wouldn't be participating in that as well?
Well, that's generally, I mean, we could if that's what the library wanted to do. But generally speaking, you know, the sponsoring organizations choose, you know, the pension plan, and then they have the other one stand alone and be just employee funded.
Okay, because I thought IMRF set that standard, like the entire company had to go with IMRF. That's not true.
No, but you do. Mm-hmm. Yeah, you do. Everybody would have to do IMRF, and then you could also have the 457B as an option.
It's a voluntary.
Okay, gotcha. Yeah.
It's
all right. Thanks. That's what I was wondering. All right, thank you.
All right, next agenda item is to go into executive session to discuss the appointment, employment, compensation, discipline, performance, or dismissal of specific employees of the Niles Provider District, to discuss minutes of closed session meetings. Do we have a motion?
I have.
Tim? For the second. The time is now 9:20 p.m. and we are reconvening the regular meeting of the Niles Public Library District Board of Trustees. Please take a roll.
Karen?
Here.
Carolyn?
Here.
Barbara left. Linda?
Here.
Tim?
Here.
Please.
Okay, I would like to move to release executive sessions for the Niles Public Library District of January 30th, 2014, February 19th, 2014, March 19th, 2014, January 21st, 2015, March 18th, 2015, July 15th, 2015, and August 19th, 2015.
I second.
And this was to approve?
This was to release.
Okay.
Tim, second.
So who made the motion?
I made the motion.
Okay, so then it's Tim.
Any discussion? Carol?
Karen?
Yes.
Carolyn?
Yes.
Linda?
Yes.
Tim?
Yes.
Okay, I would like to move to award Greg Prince a bonus for exceptional investment returns that were incurred for the library district last year in the amount of $3,500. So move.
Second.
Okay, any discussion? We appreciate everything that you did, and that was really a great year.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thanks, Greg.
Keep up. I'll talk to the fan.
Take a roll.
Karen?
Yes.
Carolyn?
Yes.
Linda?
Yes.
Tim?
Yes.
Any other?
I move to adjourn.
Anybody second?
Second.
Okay, Tim and all across the board, aye.
Aye.